All right, well, welcome. I hope everybody is having a good week. I hope y'all stayed dry this week as we were just plummeted with water. I hope that you were able to get through this week. I'm glad that you are here with us this morning. A couple of things. We are taking a break from the book of Ephesians. If you're new at Cornerstone Pickle, we do books of the Bible. We do verse by verse. It's kind of how we feel like the Lord wants us to do it. We're taking a break from the book of Ephesians, which we've been in for quite a while, and we're going to get into this morning a different book, 1 Corinthians chapter 16, to be specific, because today's Father's Day, and I want to take this time. I feel like the Lord has led us to, I want to speak to the men. I want to speak to husbands, and I want to speak to fathers this morning. And so we're going to do things a little bit differently. We have childcare available today if you need it. It is in the down the hallway to your right. But you may or may not know this, but fatherlessness in our country is somewhat of an epidemic. And I think fatherlessness is one of the reasons why this country suffers from so many societal issues. Tonight, this evening, 20 million children will go to bed tonight without a father in their home inside this country. Nearly half of African American babies are born in a home without a father figure. And children without a father figure in the home are four times more likely to live in poverty. We have a fatherless epidemic. Girls who grow up in a home without a father are twice as likely to have to be teenage mothers, to have teenage pregnancies. And this one blew me away, but 85% of juveniles who are in detention centers today come from fatherless homes. Fatherlessness is a problem. So is it that mothers are just bad at raising babies? Is that why this is a problem? And that's obviously not the problem. Most mothers are doing the best that they can, but working a full-time job to support a family as a mother with no other help in the home is near impossible. And so it's not that mothers are doing a terrible job, it's that the fathers have shirked responsibility. I learned this week, and it broke my heart, that there are nearly 2,700 single moms in Miami County alone. That's single moms that are head of household. That doesn't include the single moms who are living with grandma or living with mom. That's 2,700 people in Miami County, 2,700 mothers who are the head of household. And I pray, my prayer this morning is that God would raise up men like Jesus' adoptive father, Joseph, who are willing to come into a situation where it's messy. A blended family kind of situation where God would raise up the kind of man who is strong enough to bear the weight of a blended family. That's my prayer this morning because we need good fathers. The point is, Cornerstone, good fathers, godly fathers, are a critical element to a child's mental and spiritual health. I would go so far as to say, godly fathers, good fathers, are a critical element to the health of the church and even the health of this nation. And so I'm going to be speaking to the men this morning. So a couple of points by way of introduction. First, ladies, I don't want you to think that this is an irrelevant sermon to you, because I think you'll find that when men act like men, your world gets a lot easier. It works a lot better. God has set it up that when men do what men are supposed to do, women are able to be who God created them to be. And so don't think for a minute that this sermon, although addressed to men, is irrelevant to your life. I think that you'll find, as we move along, it is very relevant to your life. Secondly, tone. When I speak to men, I speak differently than I speak to women. I have a different tone, generally. And there's a reason for this. 1 Peter 3 says that a woman is the weaker vessel. And the apostle doesn't mean that she's weaker or less valuable. In fact, he means just the opposite of that. I think he means two things. First, in an arm wrestling match, generally speaking, the man's coming out on top. Generally speaking, unless it's Ronda Rousey that you're arm wrestling, your guys are usually going to win that battle. But I think more importantly, what Peter is saying in that moment is that a woman is more delicate. She's different. You handle her differently. I look at it like a woman is more like a wine glass. You handle it delicately. Whereas a guy is more like a thermos. He can take a tumble off the counter. He can take a ding. He's going to be all right. God has given us thick skin. So when I speak to men differently than I would speak to a woman. My tone is different. I speak more directly to men. And so I may use some phrases or language in the sermon that may seem offensive to you, but I'm not speaking directly to the women. I'm speaking to the men. And so I use different tones and different language. One more point by way of introduction, and we'll get into 1 Corinthians 16. Here at Cornerstone Piqua, we are complementarian, which means that we believe that God created man and woman different. And those differences are to be celebrated. That God made a woman in one way and made a man in another way, and they have different roles and they have different responsibilities, both in the home and both in the church. This is not to mean that one is more important than the other. In fact, I think you'll find that when men do what men do, act like men are supposed to act, a woman is able to do what she is created to be, and things just work better. So by being a complementarian, that just means that we complement one another. We are different. We accept those differences, roles, responsibilities. We complement one another. We don't believe that a woman is less than a man. And some of us may find that complementarianism is old-fashioned and even offensive. But I think you'll find from the scriptures that it is not only biblical, but it's best. So let's get into what the Bible says about manhood. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, beginning at verse 13. We're only going to do two verses this morning, as well as a little bit of time together in Ephesians. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, beginning in verse 13, the Bible says this: "Be watchful, stand firm in the faith. Act like men. Be strong. Let all that you do be done in love." Let's pray. Father, I ask this morning humbly that you would move upon me and that you would remove from me any sin, any hindrance to your word coming forth this morning, so that when I speak, it will be your words, your people hear, and it won't be my opinions. I am not their answer. Jesus, you are their answer. And Father, I pray for the men in here this morning. I pray that you would open our hearts and you would open our eyes, and that by doing so, we would see your Son. That we would see God's man, the man, Jesus the Christ. And that you would give us your grace to be like him, to act like men. In Jesus' name, and for Jesus' praise, amen. Brothers, be watchful. Be watchful. Before we look at what it means to be watchful, I think we're talking about manhood. I think the first thing we should do is we should define, what is a man? What makes a man? What is the measure of a man? Is it his physical stature? Is it the way that his body is shaped? Is it hair growing on particular places of his body? Is that what makes a man? Is it the lower voice that makes a man? What is the measure of a man? It can't be just merely physical, you understand. Because there are plenty of post-pubescent males who act like children. So there are plenty of guys who are physically men but act behaviorally like a boy. So it has to be more than just physical stature and the way your voice sounds. The Bible answers this question as to what is a man in Ephesians chapter 4. If you're taking notes, you can jot this down on the back of your handout. Ephesians 4:13 says, mature manhood is the measure and the stature of the fullness of Christ. So the answer to the question, what is a man, is Jesus is what a man is. So any discussion that talks about manhood must always point to Jesus, because Jesus is the man. He's God's man. So any discussion that has to do with manhood has to do with Jesus. The more man acts like Jesus, the more he is a man. So I want to make something very clear this morning, brothers. Your goal is to be like Jesus. Jesus is the standard for manhood. The way Jesus lived, the way he carried himself, the way he spoke, the way he gave up himself for others, the way Jesus took responsibility, the way Jesus worked tirelessly, worked selflessly to see God worked out in his disciples, that's what we're working toward. That's our standard. It means this, brothers. Your life's goal is to be the clearest example of what Jesus must have been like to live with, to work with, to talk to. You ought to be the clearest example of what Jesus would have been like that your wife knows. You have to be the clearest example. If you're a father, you have to be the clearest example of what Jesus would have been like as a father. The clearest example of Christ-likeness that your children know. It's a tremendously high calling, and not one that I will ever apologize for. But God has called every man in here to be like Jesus, that when your wife sees you, she should see Christ-likeness. When she thinks, what is Christ-likeness? What is Jesus like? Her clearest example, brothers, is to look to you. Have I set the standard high enough yet? That's the standard that God is asking of every man in this place. Jesus is the standard. What is a man? He's the measure, the stature of the fullness of Christ. And here in 1 Corinthians 16, Paul gives us five assignments, gentlemen. Five assignments. Five ways to be like Jesus. If you're taking notes, here's number one. He says, brothers, be watchful. The Greek word for be watchful means to stay awake, to be aware. It's the same word that Jesus used in the garden when he told the disciples, watch and pray. It's the same word that the apostle Peter used when he said the very same phrase, be watchful, because your adversary, the devil, is prowling around looking for someone to devour. Be watchful, stay awake, be aware. So if you're a husband in here, a father in here, be watchful. Stand guard over your homes. Something goes bump in the night, you're the one who's getting out of bed, right? Don't send her, okay? Something goes down, you're the one who faces adversity. You're the one who gets up and takes care of matters, right? We don't sit under the covers and cower and pray for our wife while she goes and fights the bad guy. You go, she stays, okay? The man goes down, the wife and kids go free. That's how God set this up. It's like this, think about every action film. That's how it goes. This is why it's so repulsive when you see You remember that scene in the movie Titanic when that weasel, just that deplorable dude, got into the boat? Do you remember that scene? When he got into the boat and women and children sank with the ship. That's deplorable to us. Because a man goes down, the woman and children go free. This is God's standard. This is what God has set up. So men, be watchful. Watch over your homes. Guard your homes. God has placed you as the head of your household. Part of this means is that you're to protect your wife and your children and your home. Also means that you're to provide what is necessary to make your home a safe environment. So if you've got a place, it's kind of in the ghetto and it's not safe. Maybe it means pulling an extra shift at work or something like that to get out of that place and get into a place where your wife feels safe. That's part of being a man. Provide a safe environment for her to grow and raise babies. And then what also means that we are to stay awake. To be watchful means that we are to be aware. Brothers, this is a tough one. Be aware. Take inventory of your family. How's your wife doing? How's her heart? How is the gospel advancing in her? Take inventory. When was the last time you asked her, "Sweetheart, how can I be praying for you?" Be aware. When was the last time you asked your kids, "How you doing? How can Daddy be praying for you? What's going on in your kids' life? What are they dealing with at school?" Be watchful. Be aware. Take stock. Does your wife feel loved, supported, appreciated? Do you even know? As a man, it is your responsibility to be aware of what's going on in your home, which means what's going on in the family, in your wife, in your children. What are your babies dealing with? What are they struggling with? Be watchful. Protect and be aware. Then Paul says, "Brothers, stand firm in the faith." A calling to manhood is a calling to stand firm, to be steadfast, to be a man like Jesus with deep roots in the gospel. Gentlemen, you are the spiritual backbone of your home. Your wife and your children are looking to you to lovingly lead them and serve them and selflessly give yourself up to see Christ formed in them. And listen, there's a lot stacked against you. The world, the flesh, and the devil, everything that can possibly be thrown at you will be thrown at you the moment you try and take a step in that direction to lovingly lead and serve your family and to see Christ formed in them. You know how much easier it is? I have young kids, so you know how much easier it is for me to throw the ball with my kids than it is to lead them in a Bible study? It's so much more difficult to lead them in a Bible study. There's so much more stacked against me. My flesh doesn't want to do it. Certainly the enemy doesn't want it to happen. But every single one of us must stand firm in the faith, have secure footing, an unyielding commitment to Christ, such as to weather adversity and to stand firm, to pour into them when they need strength. When your wife is struggling after a long, hard day, you're to bring her strength. You're to tap into the infinite stream of God's grace and pour in His strength into her. The same thing with your babies. Do the same thing. But yet I find that too many guys they're not strong in the faith. They're not firm in the faith. They have this mamby-pamby, like limp-wristed form of spirituality. They're spiritually weak, theologically weak. Too weak to lead their family, spiritually speaking. It's just too many cases, I think, where the wife has to be the one to get the husband to get out of bed and to go to church. Are you kidding me? That your family's spiritual well-being is of such a matter of indifference to you that you can't be bothered to get out of church on a Sunday morning and to get them into that building. We start at 10:30. How late do you sleep really? And yet, as a father, as a husband, as a leader of your home, you ought to be the one who's getting everybody up, getting everybody bathed, getting everybody's hair done, getting everybody ready to go to church, because you know that's important for them to be in that building to hear the word of God. That's a calling of a man. Stand firm in the faith. Which means this, guys. In order for you to lead your family, love your family, and to do what Christ has called you to do, you have to stand firm in the faith. You have to develop that unyielding commitment to Christ. And the only way to get that is for you to take ownership of the spiritual disciplines in your own life, meaning you need to be in the Scriptures on your own, devouring the Word. You need to spend hours in the Word and in prayer, individually. That's the only way you're going to be equipped for the high calling of being Christ in your home. It's the only way. Which means you're going to have to maybe shift your schedule around a little bit. Maybe get up early in the morning to get time before in the Word and prayer before the Lord, so that you can be equipped to serve your family. Devour the Scriptures, men. I think devotionals are good. I think they're very good. They can be very good. I think devotionals are really good for like a lunch break at work. But what I'm talking about is devouring the Scriptures. I think devotionals are good, but they're vitamins. I'm talking about eating a whole meal. I'm talking about getting before the Word and digesting Scripture, of digging into it, of being changed into the likeness and image of Christ by reading His Word, learning who He is, really digging deep, guys. More than just a devotional before the Lord. Use that as a supplement, but dig deep. Let your roots go deep. It's the only way you're going to stand firm in the faith. We'll get to this in a minute, but the strength isn't in you. God isn't asking you to just stand there and grit your teeth. The strength to do what God has called you to do isn't there. It's not in you. It's in Christ Jesus. And the only way to tap into that is by picking up this book and devouring it, making it priority in your life. So it may mean that you have to get up earlier. It may mean that you have to sacrifice time at the gym. I don't know what it's going to look like for you, but your strength doesn't come from the gym. Your strength comes from Jesus. And so you've got to go to Jesus to get that strength. It may mean asking those hard questions about your time. Is what I'm doing in this moment right now equipping me to serve my family as Christ has called me to? Those are hard questions, but they're all questions that we have to ask. And it may mean radical changes, but Jesus stood firm in the faith. Jesus put a priority on prayer, and Jesus put a priority of understanding the Scriptures. Therefore, men, we put a priority on prayer and understanding the Scriptures. Your third point. Your next assignment, brothers, is to act like men. Too many of us, I think, don't act like men. We act like boys. Wasteful, unproductive. And you know, when little kids do it, it's cute. But when men do it, it's destructive. God has called you to act like a man. Huffington Post wrote an article a couple of years ago showing that the median age of people getting married for the first time is at an all-time high. In 1960, the average woman married at age 20, and the average man married at age 23. Today, the average woman gets married at age 27, and the average man gets married for the first time at age 29. And this change has come in large part due to a significant rise in cohabitation rates. I think it's a full 48% of couples cohabitate before they get married. And I submit to you that part of the reason for this is because men aren't acting like men, they're acting like boys. Because you see, the difference between a man and a boy is responsibility. And the difference between cohabitation and marriage is the same. Because it's far easier. A lot of guys would, instead of going out and getting an education and getting a solid job and getting a wife and building a family and working hard, most guys would rather shirk that responsibility and just do a hookup and shack up kind of responsibility, which is to say no responsibility. Because how many of you know it's difficult to have a full-time job, to raise a family, to raise babies, to love a wife, while still being able to play video games 3 hours per day? It's a challenge. Though many have tried, it's a challenge. I didn't make up that number. That's the average age of a 20-something video gamer. Or that's the average amount of hours that they spend playing video games. Act like men means be like Jesus, means take responsibility, brothers. Brothers, listen. While we were out busy chasing sex and fun and money, Jesus was busy living the life that we should have lived. And while we were out busy chasing sex and money and fun, Jesus died the death we deserve to die because we spent our time chasing money and sex and fun. Jesus took responsibility for something that wasn't his fault. The guiltless gave himself up for the guilty. Your sin and mine were placed on Jesus, the sinless sacrifice. He did nothing to deserve the murder that he took on the cross. You and I put him there by our sins. And Jesus took the responsibility of sin, though it wasn't his fault. And so what I'm telling you as a man is that what problems are going on in your home may not always be your fault, but I promise you, in the eyes of God, they are always your responsibility. Mama might have a hot hand with the credit card, and you might have all kind of financial problems. That might not be your fault. Certainly is your responsibility, though. When your life ends and you stand before God, brothers, you're going to have to give an account for what went on in your home. Of how your wife is doing, of your stewardship of the finances he provided for you. It's the calling of manhood. Jesus was responsible, even though things weren't his fault. Brothers, be responsible. Act like men. Your next assignment, brothers, is to be strong. To be strong. Strong like what? Open the pickle jar strong, or a different kind of strong? Maybe the pickle jar thing, probably what Paul means here is strong in the Lord and the power of his might kind of strong. Spiritually strong. And as I told you before, that strength that you are to demonstrate in your home doesn't come from inside here. It comes from up there. The strength that you need as a man doesn't come from the gym. It comes from Jesus. You are to give yourself to see Christ formed in your family, and that takes a tremendous amount of strength. Brothers, every bit that you have. At the end of the day, you will be tapped out if you're doing this right. Physically, mentally exhausted. But I promise you, God will supply every need when you go before him in prayer. Be strong means channeling God's power, the power of God's Spirit, into desperate and sometimes delicate situations in your home. Desperate and delicate situations in your wife's heart, in your children's hearts, with your grandkids. Be strong in the Lord means channeling God's power into that place. So when your woman has had a tough day, or she's sick, or the kids are being savages, you're to be the strong one in that situation. You're to bring the strength God supplies into that situation. You're to be the shoulder she's to lay her head on. Am I being clear? This is why God gave you broad shoulders and leather skin. Because she's to lay, your kids are to sit on your lap, your wife is to lay her head on your shoulder. You're to be the strong one in the home. Be strong, brothers. So when you come home from work just exhausted, and the last thing you want to do is get down on the ground with the kids and play cars for the umpteenth time, be strong, brothers. And when you're just mentally zapped, if you have a demanding job, you're just mentally zapped and you come home from work and the last thing you want to do is sit with your wife and say, sweetheart, how can I pray for you? How are you doing today? And you want to hear her go on and on and on and on and on about every mundane detail in her day, and you don't feel like hearing it. You don't feel like talking to her about those things. You just want to go into the man cave and shut things down. You've got to stand in that moment, listen with your ears, and be strong. The strength to do this isn't in you, and it's certainly not in me. The strength to do this is in Jesus alone. This is why you may need to get up early that day. You may need to devour the scriptures, because you're not going to be able to pull from any other well. That's the inexhaustible well that you've got to go to every day in order to draw from and get that strength that you get to your wife and to talk with her and to love her and to pray with her and to be strong for her when she's feeling down and to be the shoulder she can cry on, rely on, to be selfless, to give yourself up for the sake of her. A lot of us have made messes, and it's just time to clean it up. I think maybe we've believed in a lie. I think maybe the enemy has convinced us of something that it's not honorable to fight those battles in the house, in the home. That you win honor out of the house. That you win honor as a man in the workplace, with the amount of direct reports that you have, or how nice your house is on the weekends, or whatever you spend your free time doing. And I think we think that that's where honor is really won. And there's honor out there, don't get me wrong, but you know where real honor is won? It happens in the home. When you lead and love your family and give yourself up for her and you see Christ formed in your spouse, that's where honor is won. That there's a battle going on for the hearts of your kids and for your spouse. the enemy is ravaging families. And we got guys who are not willing to hold the line and fight the fight. And they would rather go into their man cave and do a six-pack and ESPN. And that's how they want to spend their free time. You know what that's called? Cowardice. I'm all for man caves. If you use a man cave as your place to go to be equipped with the Word of God and prayer in order to reach out to your family, but that's not usually what it is. Man caves are usually a retreat from the battle. It's where you go, we don't feel like asking your wife how she's really doing. It's where you go when you don't want to confront all the problems of the kids when you come home from work. We are called to be strong. Jesus didn't back down from a fight, and he didn't break under hardship. He didn't fold under pressure. He didn't retreat from battle, and he didn't bawl his eyes out when the Pharisees didn't like him. Jesus had a steel spine, and he had leather skin, and we are called to stand and be strong like Jesus in our home, regardless of what's set up against us, regardless of whether we feel like it or not. So when your family is under attack, brothers, hold the line. When the enemy is charging up the hill, hold the line. You can't retreat from this battle. You only get one chance at this. I have to remind myself of this all the time. I have four babies. I only get one chance to be their father. There is honor. I don't know what you had in your mind when you were 20-something. I don't know what you thought when you were 20-something and what your life would look like when you were 50. I don't know. Maybe you thought it would be this or that. Regardless of what you thought, there is honor in the responsibility that God has given you to love your wife and serve her and to see Christ formed in her and to prepare her for the day where she'll meet Jesus. And there is honor in the children that God has placed into your life that you get to be a father to. Regardless of whether what your life looks like when you're 50 or 60 or when you close your eyes for the last time, you had the chance to raise a wife who will live forever or children who will live forever. You may not become the great man that you thought you would become, but you were given a chance to raise babies and to serve a spouse. And one day, your wife will stand before Jesus. And you know, part of what happens during that time, that conversation she has with him, is your responsibility. You are to be preparing her for that appointment. It's a tremendous responsibility. And there's a tremendous amount of honor in it. The final thing Paul says is this, brothers. Let all that you do be done in love. And for this, I want you to turn to Ephesians chapter 5. If you've studied the Bible, you knew this verse was coming. Ephesians chapter 5, whatever you do, brothers, let all be done in love. There's a time to be tough, guys. There's a time to be tender. Sometimes your toughness is needed. At other times, your tenderness is needed. You need to have both. As a father, specifically, I'll speak to the fathers. There are times when you got to be tough. You got to be tough with them kids. But if you're only tough, that doesn't work. You'll break them. You have to be tender. These two things have to be balanced. If you're only tender, you're going to have wild children. You have to be tough, and you have to be tender. Ephesians chapter 5, guys, verse 25. Husbands, love your wives. There's that word again. And here's your standard. As Christ loved the church. And gave himself up for her. That he might sanctify her. Which means set her apart. Make her set apart for a specific purpose. Having cleansed her by the washing of the water with the word. And verse 27 says, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. Love your wives as Christ loved the church. How did Christ love the church? He gave himself up for her that he might sanctify her, set her apart, wash her with the water of the word to prepare her for the day when he presents her to himself. Okay, you see in the connection, guys? We are to give ourselves up for the sake of our wives to see Christ formed in her, to set her apart, to prepare her for the time when she is presented to Christ, spotless and without blemish. And so many guys are out there, they're the ones making the spots and blemishes. Rather than being the one who's removing the spots and blemishes, washing her with the water of the word, they're the ones dirtying her. And those men are fools. I want to make sure that we understand what Paul means by love your wives. Because when you say, hey man, I can check that off a box, I love my wife. Let's make sure we're talking about the same thing. Because when you talk about love, I know what you're thinking. That might not be what Paul means. Probably isn't. What does Paul mean by love your wife? Part of this means loving her in a way that she receives love. We're just naturally inclined to love her in a way that we receive love. But God has called you to love her in the way that she receives love. And so for some of us, that means we're going to have to develop a better vocabulary beyond like nods and grunts. We have to develop a vocabulary to let her know how you feel about her, to let her know that she's appreciated. Here's what I recommend to you. This isn't natural, by the way. The romance, some of us, we need to become a romantic. That's not natural. We're just not naturally romantic people. Some guys are. God bless them. They get that. We don't. Most guys, I'm not a romantic person by nature. So if that's you, if you're not spending your free time working on poetry, then here's what I would recommend for you. Cheat. I'm not kidding. I bought a book of sonnets by William Shakespeare. Not even making this up. In my office today, there's a bunch of sonnets from William Shakespeare. He's a master. I wanted to learn from the master. I don't know how to talk in flowery, lovey language. That's not me. So I had to cheat. I had to go to the master and learn. I also learned you can't copy word for word. She's going to know, right? She figures it out. You don't talk like this. You've never used the word ye in your life. But you take his example. Use like an amplified Bible kind of approach. You know, it's just concept by concept. You look at the master and you use that on your wife. Communicate the love that you have to her. Here's another thing I'd recommend. Next time you buy her a card, don't buy a Hallmark. You're going to spend $5 on a Hallmark card that some other dude sonnet and serenade to his wife. You're just signing your name at the bottom and giving it to your own. 100 other guys are doing the same thing to their wife. Isn't that bizarre to anyone else? Would you let a guy come into your home and sing a song to your wife, serenade her, and then you just come in at the end and be like, that was for me? You wouldn't. And yet, this is what a Hallmark card is. Here's what I recommend you do. Buy the blank ones. It forces you to have to write in your own words how you, say it with me, guys, feel. I promise you'll appreciate it. There's language. There's, go to the Masters. There's a book in the Bible, by the way, that will help you with this called Song of Solomon. You're going to have to be careful with that one because sometimes there's compliments in there that don't translate too well, right? Unless your wife likes to hear that her hair reminds you of a flock of goats, then by all means. But otherwise, she's not going to get that, right? She's not going to be like, what? A flock of goats? Are you serious? This is our anniversary. So love her like Jesus loves the church, which is to say, give yourself up. Be spent to see Christ formed in her. To save her, sanctify her. You can't forgive her sins. You can't atone for her sins, but you can lead her to the one who did. So save her, sanctify her, refers to leading her to Jesus, washing her with the water of the word. And do this, brothers, selflessly. This isn't currency. This isn't, I bought you a card, so I expect something tonight. Do this selflessly. Give yourself up for her. Because that thing that'll happen at night will happen, I promise. But you do this selflessly. Without expecting anything in return. Because to you, the win isn't what happens at night. To you, the win is seeing Christ formed in her. So that when she stands before Jesus, you present her ready to meet Jesus. Here's your application points this morning. If you had your little card that you tore off when you came in, here's your application points for the week. And here's your assignments for the week. Application point number one that you can write on your connection card is this. Check in with your wife, husbands. Check in, see how she's doing. Be watchful, be aware. See how she's doing for real. What's going on in your life? Baby, how can I pray for you? How can I love you? What would it take to make her feel loved, appreciated, supported, safe? What would it take? Take inventory. That's your assignment this week. And ladies, here's number two. Be gracious with us. The chances are, I love you guys, but the chances are, ladies, you married a bonehead. We're pretty lousy at being like Jesus. Let's be honest. I'm not trying to tell you that I got this right. I'm not the person you're trying to be like. You're trying to be like Jesus. So ladies, give us a little bit of grace. Be honest with us, to be sure. But tell him, what can he do to make you feel loved and appreciated, supported? Be honest with him. Give him actual things. Guys are good with actual things. We like to have a problem, get a tool, fix the problem. That's why when you explain that your day was hard, he wants to come at you with some kind of solution. He's already got an action plan. Number one, we're going to do this. Then number two, when that's done, we're going to do this. Number three, you're going to be happy. Game over. That's how it works. And chances are you're not looking for him to find any kind of solution. You're just wanting to talk to him. So this week, ladies, if your husband has the guts to come to you and say, hey, baby, how can I pray for you? How can you feel appreciated and loved? Tell him. Don't nag. Please don't nag. Please don't nag. Did I say that yet? Please don't nag. But say it in a way that only a godly woman can say. Use language, the tenderness, and the pure words that only a godly woman can use. And tell him. Give him something to do. And then lastly, guys, I'll speak specifically to you. I think it's time for us to take responsibility in life. To take responsibility for the way we spend our time, the way we spend our money, to take responsibility for the words we speak, how we are leading in our homes, how we are leading at our job, how we are moving our family towards mission of seeing Christ formed in them and glorifying God in all things in the church and through the church. Take responsibility over your home, take responsibility at work, and take responsibility here at the church. Alternatively, if you're a single woman in here, a lot of this didn't apply to you, but here's what I would ask of you. Pray for the men of the church. This church needs godly men. This church needs selfless men. America needs godly, selfless men. Pray for them. Intercede for them. And your memory verse this week, you can write this on your application card, is 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 13. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I ask you as a man that you would forgive me and that you would forgive men when we have outsourced responsibility, when we have shirked it, when we have skirted around it, expecting someone else to do it for us, or just expecting Christ to be formed in our family without our involvement. Forgive us, Father, for being like the first man and not the last one. Forgive us when we have committed sins by doing what we shouldn't have done, and forgive us when we commit sins for not doing what we should have done. And I pray in this place and in the churches across this nation that you would raise up men strong in the Lord and the power of his might, men who are willing to give up themselves to see Christ worked out and formed in their family. And I pray specifically, Father, for men like Joseph to adopt, to go into a situation of a mixed family with all the dynamics and to bring strength there and to love a girl and to marry her and support her and to get them babies into church for your glory and our good. In Jesus' name we pray. Cornerstone Piqua said amen. Stand to your feet. Act like men. Gentlemen, be a man. Ladies, pray for and support your man for the glory of God, for the good of your home, and for the building up of his church. Amen.